Dr. Hildebrandt was born and raised in Ohio, went to schools and colleges throughout Ohio. He received his bachelor's degree at Kent State, summa cum laude, by the way. His master's of arts degree in sociology also at Keene State, and he attained his PhD at The Ohio State University, Columbus, Ohio. Dr. Hildebrandt has taught at Keene State, Ohio State, and since 1969 at Keene State in New Hampshire. He has been a visiting professor in Belgium and is a member of various professional organizations, a long list which I won't go into, but I will mention one, the Association of Holocaust Organizations, where he is a member of the board of directors. And Dr. Hildebrandt, since I believe 1983, was the founder and the director of the Holocaust Resource Center at Keene State College. Thank you. Dr. Hildebrandt.
Thank you very much for that introduction and for the invitation to come today to talk with you. I've got so many slides to show you that I don't think we'll have enough time. They'll look more like motion pictures flying through than perhaps slides. And that's going to be the major focus. I just want to say just a very few words of the fact that with the name Hildebrandt, it might make you suspect that I'm not myself a Jew, but a non-Jew, and that's rather rare as directors of Holocaust centers go. But it was my own history as a child growing up in Ohio in a largely Jewish neighborhood that I became aware, even during World War II, of the consequences of the Holocaust, both among the Jews in the neighborhood, but also Gentiles in the neighborhood, unfortunately sometimes relatives, who said things like, Hitler is terrible, but at least he's doing one good thing. And as a child, I figured out what they meant, and that was that he was killing the Jews. Which also runs counter to the idea that many Americans at that time and later said they didn't know that it was going on. If that was true, then I don't know how they could say something like that. So early on, I guess I became interested in the question of prejudice and anti-Semitism, focused upon that to a great extent through my college courses and so on. And so about 10 years ago, I decided that I wanted to retool, if you will, to some extent, and focus upon the Holocaust after going to a conference in Philadelphia, 3 days of testimony, survivors and liberators and scholars from all over the world. I knew that I needed finally a sabbatical and took one, and the consequences of that sabbatical was to establish a Holocaust Resource Center at Keene State College, which seemed a very peculiar thing. I think it still does to some people, why in that particular corner of New Hampshire, of all places, and to create a course on the Holocaust, which I now teach at least once a year, entitled The Sociology of the Holocaust. Anyway, that's how that all has come to be this morning, but I would, in not false humility, say I'm no expert on the Holocaust. I am a student of the Holocaust, still learning, and there is so much to learn that I don't think any of us will ever be able to sort of conquer this particular event. Having said that, I'd like to get to the slides now, and as I say, I'll go very quickly, and I do want to allow time for questions at the end. First few pictures are pictures of Prague. This is a trip which was organized by the Association of Holocaust Organizations last summer. It was open to the whole world, but largely focused upon directors of Holocaust centers. 17 people bought into the trip, so it was a rather small group. The photographs, by the way, are all taken by my wife, who is a good, fairly competent photographer, but my experience is I usually have about half my fingers on, so otherwise this would not be much of a slideshow. We started in Prague, the new Czech Republic, as it is called, and I just showed us it's a city that was totally standing today as it was before damaged about the war. And the architecture is splendid. It's a wonderful city filled with music. The reason I show this slide is the building at the end of the chopped in two by the Nazis because they didn't like it, and so it's sort of a chopped off building. That's the only building during World War II. This is the very famous Prague Jewish Cemetery, very old, It's the picture through the gate, and unfortunately later got in there, but not with the camera. Some more interesting slides of that. This building in the foreground is the oldest synagogue in Prague and one of the oldest in Europe, again, undamaged by the war. That's a modern statue of Moses. So there is a Jewish community, I don't think, but a Jewish community in Prague, and we had kosher meals in the Jewish, that goes back centuries, where Franz Kafka often delivered lectures. Where it is still in the Czech Republic, a few shots here of Theresienstadt. In the Czech, it would be Terezin. This is what was called Hitz. This is a town. It looks just as it did back then, except during surrounded by a fence, and famous Jews, prominent Jews, Jews of, and many, many children were placed into this camp. It was visited by the International Red Cross, and things were for that visit up, and it looked very nice, but the day after the filming, a film made of this camp, and after the film was made and the Red Cross was gone, shipped to Auschwitz. So much for this, what's sometimes called one of the... this is still a Theresien, or Theresienstadt. This is the cemetery, represents many bodies. So people did die in Theresien, even though it was the Jews, and of course the large menorah. There was a, is standing, the crematorium at Theresien, a very small scale, one die at Theresien. It was a place where people did starve to death, and many also were shipped, as I said, east on the trains. This is, our photography is not good on interiors, so you have to squint to make some things out, but this is the small one. Compared to most of the Nazi crematoria, you can see a candle burning here in memorial on one of the mechanisms that pushed the bodies into the fire. Here you can clearly how the bodies would be laid in and then pushed in to the oven. The Jews in our group, there were only four of us who were not Jews on the trip, but saying Kaddish here, place where mass death occurred, Kaddish was said on our trip. Still Theresien, but this is the fort at that, just outside of the village. Very few Jews were put into this prison. This was mostly Nazi, those who were prison and so on. Anyway, it's a very forbidding place. It looks on the outside, but very dank and a horrible place on the inside. Down is not very clear for you, but it says Arbeit macht frei, work makes you free, but this is a prison, and that's advertising. In a prison. Here we're flocking in to go to a cell where the assassin of the Archduke Ferdinand, which was the initial event to start, kept in a cell in there, and so we're looking there. But also in there was a very tiny, the smallest of all cells for Jewish prisoners. They had one bucket, one little bucket, both for toilet and for drinking. So it was the worst cell in all of that prison. Now we're in Krakow, which is our place where we're staying, ready to visit Auschwitz, which is about an hour's drive from Krakow. Krakow is the cultural capital of Poland. This is a synagogue, totally deserted, deteriorating. It's very filthy because the communists on the occupied Poland punished this city because it's the city of intellectuals and scholars and universities, and so they set up a huge smelting plant and everything in Krakow is filthy. But this synagogue is there, but the Jews are long gone. There are very few Jews left in Poland. Now we're, of course, of the what most consider the worst hell of all within the Holocaust history. And this is Auschwitz I. Auschwitz is divided into three parts, Auschwitz I, Auschwitz II, which is Auschwitz-Birkenau, and three Motowice, which is where the factories were located for slave labor. Anyway, this is very busy with Polish tourists. This is sort of almost sacred national patriotic grounds to them. This is where the Poles who were resisting the Nazis were often brought here, tortured, killed, and so on. But relatively few Jews in this part of the camp. And again, the sign Arbeit macht frei, a false advertising that somehow you would survive as a free person if you work there. This just shows the double fencing. I don't know why that goes out of focus. See, that would be on the machine, I guess. Whoops. No. Oh, well, it keeps going out. I don't know. I don't see anything on this to move it. Anyway, let's hope the others clear out. Okay, this is one of the many red brick buildings along this sort of street or avenue in Auschwitz I, but the sign on the wall indicates that in that building, women were sterilized and medical experimentation was conducted upon women. These very substantial buildings are filled now with exhibits. One floor of one of these buildings is just a huge mass of women's hair, which was shaved off of them before they would go into the gas chambers. And some of that was used commercially to make blankets and material and so on. Here you see all the market baskets, all the baskets that people brought with them on the cattle car trains and which were taken from them, just heaped up and so on. So if you see the museum in Washington, the new Holocaust Museum, you see many of those kinds of artifacts there. Here is the infamous place where firing squads were assassinating resistors and sometimes Jews. This is still Auschwitz I, and the prisoners were on both sides, and they could hear all day long the killing of people, knowing they would be next in line eventually. So this was, there are flowers down there perpetually commemorating people who were killed there. This is still Auschwitz I. This is our group standing here, but there's the wall of the end of Auschwitz I, and the huge building that you see beyond the wall is where the convent was, where the nuns lived, and the last ones had left 2 weeks before we arrived on this trip, and they also the big cross is taken down. This was considered, and I fully agree, as somehow inappropriate at a place like Auschwitz to have a cross looming over the gate. But in any case, that building, which they did occupy as a convent, was where the Zyklon B gas was stored during the war itself. Here we're still at Auschwitz I, and before they developed gas chambers at Auschwitz, this is where they put Russian prisoners of war or partisans, the brickwork is torn down here, but those are just those little compartments. They put four or five people in each of those, shut the door, and they would suffocate. This is the crematorium. You see the mound. I'm sorry about, again, the fuzziness. That is where they, for Auschwitz I, so it was not a large one. Also on this plaza here was where the commandant, after the Nuremberg trials, the commandant of Auschwitz was hanged. At that particular location. Okay, this is really the exit from the crematorium, but they're using it as the entrance for tourists, and we're going in to the crematorium. And here is the furnace. There's just a couple ovens in there, and you can see constantly flowers are brought to commemorate the dead at these locations. I used to hear about, and others have, that it seems almost sacrilegious in a way to have lunch at Auschwitz, but it's a long day, and there we are with our tour bus in the background having lunch on the grass at Auschwitz, but there's not much way you can avoid it. It's a very large place. Here we are ready to enter Auschwitz. Again, I don't know if anybody could work the machine. I don't know whether that would help. This is the very famous entrance through which the trains would go, and today you can walk anywhere you want around through there and also go up in the tower. And here is still another shot, a little more distant, different angle. There's nothing on this. Good, thank you. From up in the tower, we're looking down now. You can see the railroad tracks here, which brought the deliveries of people in. You can still see the platform. It's about a mile, and the track just dead ends abruptly, and it's down there where the crematoria, the gas chambers and the crematoria were located. They're all blown up now. You'll see them, but the Nazis destroyed them before the Russians liberated Auschwitz. But this is the women's side of the camp, and wherever you see a chimney, that's where there were barracks, but many of them are now gone. Looking in the other direction, you see the men's side of the camp. Men and women were constantly separated, one from the other. Children usually are sent with the women. Anyone under 15 would be sent with the women. Remember, too, that at the selection on the platform when the train pulled in, only about 30% would be selected for slave labor. 70% would be at Auschwitz, would be sent, excuse me, to the gas chambers within about 2 hours. So life expectancy was extremely brief there. Here you see the latrines. Every few buildings, among all those barrack buildings, are latrines, so it's mass production type of latrine, very crude. And usually about 50,000 people trying to have access to just one building like that. It would be a lucky day indeed if there was even a dribble of running water available for people to drink. Thirst was one of the most horrid aspects of this, people suffering from thirst. Here's another row of latrines on the other side of that building. Here again, these are very darkly lighted. There is really no lighting inside except that which comes in near the top of the building. But these are the original barracks, of course, in which sometimes 5 to 6 to 7 to 8 people slept in each one of those compartments. And here's a shot that was recommended to us to try to get, but again, the light doesn't go far enough, but that's just looking down through this very long barracks of barracks on top of one another. This is the entrance after they walk down here, or if they were on the platform, the women would go through that gate. Right over here, and we forgot to get a shot of it, was the men's gate. So they're right opposite each other. So families would see them each other for the last time as they were divided by gender at that point. This picture we took because of something lovely at Auschwitz, some flowers. This used to be high in grass for many, many years. Just now the Polish government is starting to sort of take care of Auschwitz too. And here's a local farm family who are doing the mowing and cutting the grass. And you can see they have their children out here, a little young one, one just slightly older, all of them working together on cleaning up the new mowed grass. Wherever you see places that are concave in the soil at these death camps, that means where they dumped a lot of ashes. So that would be one place where if you dig down through that grass, you would find ashes from the crematoria. All right, here's how the Nazis left the crematoria and the gas chambers. They were one large unit, and so they blew it up, and they indicate on the signs exactly what occurred there. This is our group standing there. Here, again, you can see it all crumbled into the earth. There'll be a better shot of the lineup here. Here you can see how long the building was. Down at the far end would be where people would enter into the undressing room, then into the gas chamber, and then, of course, they would be burned in the crematorium. So it was three compartments. That's what the Nazis did before the Russians came. They blew them all up. Here, again, a little fuzzy, but you can see the tracks left here for the carts to be rolled when the Sonderkommando, who were prisoners themselves, would gather the bodies out of the gas chamber and then take them into the ovens. So it was a 24-hour type of operation. And so they wheeled the carts on those rails. And so over here would be the ovens. Over here was the gas chamber. Here we are standing. So glad you're there. Thank you. Ready to say Kaddish. We're saying Kaddish here. The man with the white hat on is a survivor, and this is his first time back in Poland since he fled, finally, during the war itself. He lost his entire family to the Holocaust. Here, the woman in the darker blue is from Pittsburgh, and she's commemorating her grandparents who were killed at Auschwitz, and she's helping with the Kaddish. She also prayed for all those who died there. Here we are at the opposite end of the tower. You can see how far down it is. Here is a great memorial indicating how many people died in each of the countries during the Holocaust. Actually, they've erased all those numbers because of the deniers, the revisionists who are denying the Holocaust. These numbers were bloated numbers. They're too large in numbers, so they're going to get much more accurate figures to try to hush up the deniers, but I think there's no chance of that anyway. Here's one. You can see the makeup a little clearer of the undressing room, the gas chamber, and finally the crematorium. Here is what in these large death camps was called Canada. To the prisoners in these camps, Canada was a huge North American country that was very rich. And here was the richest place, if you will, in a place like Auschwitz. All the valuable things which people brought with them on the trains, hoping to have their keepsakes or be able to trade with them or even bribe perhaps some people, all these were confiscated. And the best job you could get as a prisoner in a place like Auschwitz was Canada, where you were sorted through all this and maybe could put some of it in your pocket and again trade it off within the camp itself. Also, you could find food, and the clothing was piled up very high, and you could go through the pockets looking for extra food and so on. So that was the best job you could have. But anyway, this is a pile of forks, spoons, and knives, which are just covered with this grating. They're just going into ruin out in the open elements. All right, now we're at Majdanek, which is another death camp. There were six death camps in Poland. Majdanek is pretty much straight death. In other words, it's very little slave labor. There's nothing done at Majdanek except the processing of death. And so this is one of the gas chambers. Walk right in. You see faintly in the background a big concrete bathtub. They were experimenting at Majdanek with gas, and they found that by soaking people in hot water, the gas would take effect quicker. So that's not a friendly bath. The little white spots are defective film. We don't know what they mean. This is another shot of that very same room. You can see that there would, it's not a small room, but it's not huge either. And literally there could be 2,000 to 3,000 people jammed into a room that size, throwing the children and babies on top just to fill in any gaps in space. This is another gas chamber, a smaller one at Majdanek. And we won't take the time with that, but in five different languages it tells you that they were experimenting with carbon monoxide first by simply running gasoline engines with exhausts in there. That was too slow. Zyklon B is used later, which is a cyanide gas, and that takes about 10 minutes, though they usually keep the doors sealed for 20 to 30 minutes. Here you can even see where the Nazis could look through and supervise the gassing and watch it, if you're inclined to watch such a horror. Again, more information about the experimentation and trying to work out a smoother system of death. This is a really ghastly spot. This is the back of that gas chamber building, and you can see the little bridges across this trough. That's where when gassings were done, all the body fluids from people are urine, feces, menses, vomit, and so on. I'm sorry to talk like this to you, but that would just drain out. They'd have to clean that out, the prisoners, and it would be flowing down through that channel. Another disturbing thing about this particular spot is on those doors, and unfortunately our picture didn't come out, but there, those heavy doors were made in Berlin, and an imprint in the metal states the name of the manufacturer, Gas Chamber Door. So the German industry was profiting off of the manufacture of that kind of door. This is the front of the building. We've just been to the back, now we're on the front. And the Nazis referred to this as the Rose Garden, meaning the people had to take their clothes off before they would go into the entrance. It says it's a shower, it's not. But it indicates that on the door. And so women and men would be gassed separately, but apparently, especially in winter, but the women standing naked, their skins turned pink or rose colored, and the Nazis always had a delight of calling it the Rose Garden. These are really very dark, and I apologize for that, but now we're into the crematorium itself, which is a separate building, some distance, so all the bodies had to be moved by carts to the crematorium. Oh, this is one of the many barracks at Majdanek, and it just would take a super camera to get the light. It's just dark in there. But this barracks is very long, and it's filled to the ceiling with children's shoes. Children's shoes, filled, just as they were. They're just heaped in there. And one of our elderly members of the trip simply sat down and wept. Here is Majdanek, much cruder fencing, but still double and electrified compared to Auschwitz. Here are some more barracks at Majdanek. These are left even with the original bedding still today, although the Russians put prisoners of war in there after they captured the camp and used it. Here, these pictures are going to be a little intermixed, but this is the huge memorial now at Majdanek, and you can see a heap under the dome. That's all ashes, all the accumulated ashes from Majdanek. You'll see other shots in a moment. Here is the dissecting room, just outside the gas chamber, between that and the ovens at Majdanek. Here's where they dissected bodies, cutting open the stomach, and looking for any valuables that might have been swallowed. Here's still another shot of one of the gas chambers. That's sort of out of sequence here at Majdanek. Here are human bones on display. This is considered perhaps improper. But it's simply the Polish government which has provided this, but that's maybe a bit unfitting to expose the bones of the dead in that fashion. Here are the ovens at Majdanek, probably the best preserved of the ovens in death camps, and these are seen in the famous film Night and Fog. Again, Kaddish is said here, where thousands and thousands of Jews were killed. You can see the candles from the Kaddish. At this spot, now notice you can see the city of Lublin, the large Polish city of Lublin, just here. It came right up to the edge of Majdanek. Today it comes right up to the edge. But usually they put these camps far away from large populations. But people of Lublin had to know what was going on over at Majdanek. And today it comes right up to the fence, the city itself. These swellings in the ground and concavities are the result of 18,000 Jews. The furnaces weren't quick enough. The ovens weren't quick enough. 18,000 Jews were brought into the camp, and in the space of one day between sunrise and sunset, 18,000 Jews were killed at that spot. The earth takes that shape largely because of that uneven burial ground. Here we are at the memorial, and you can see, you can look down into the pit, you can see the massive number of ashes of the dead collected there. Here again, you see the other half of it. You can't get it all into, at least not our camera. And here you can get back from it, and you can see how large it is. And here, standing, there's Lublin, the city of Lublin. Look at how close. And it's literally now up to the fence, which is out there. City buses run by Majdanek all the time. Very crude architecture at Majdanek. Here is in Lublin. One of the very last Jews in Lublin, the man in the white hat and sweater, this is an old Jewish cemetery which is falling apart and crumbling. He asked to speak Yiddish, Hebrew, and German, and so some of our group could speak those languages, and so he's asking for small donations. He's trying to rebuild alone the cemetery, get the stones up again, and even to get some blocks so that people can walk without falling. It's very rough and uneven, so it was very, very sad. Here, a businessman built this memorial made out of old Jewish cemetery stones. It represents the Holocaust, Jewish history, but with the break, that represents the breach of the Holocaust in history. And behind that in the woods is an old Jewish cemetery just collapsing and rotting. My wife standing there in front of one of the very few old, almost ancient Jewish buildings in all of Poland. This is a kosher slaughterhouse. Still standing at that time. Otherwise, there are no Jews in that village at all. This is just a shot of the main plaza or grand place in Warsaw. This was completely destroyed in the Blitzkrieg when Germany suddenly attacked Poland in 1939. They have reconstructed it exactly as it was at the time. So it was quite a project. Nothing there is original, but that is a reconstruction of it. But in essentially downtown Warsaw, this is the memorial on this side to the resistance fighters in the Jewish ghetto, which they actually drove the Germans out of the ghetto twice within the space of a month. By the way, France, certain countries, Belgium, Holland, Denmark, and other countries fell quicker than the Jews gave up the Warsaw ghetto. So it was quite a standoff for a while. On the other side of the memorial is a Holocaust monument commemorating the Holocaust. Here is Mila 18, which was the headquarters of the resistance fighters in the Warsaw ghetto. And we each took turns reading certain passages from their diaries. Here is all that's left, a couple of spots in Warsaw where you still see the ghetto, which was built by the Jews under the gun of the Germans to seal off the Jewish community and then pour people in there where starvation and disease destroyed hundreds of thousands. Here's another portion of the wall that's still standing. There are new apartment buildings all around this area. Here is the huge Jewish cemetery. It's very old and traditional in Warsaw. It's going just into weeds and falling apart, but this is off to the side, a statue commemorating Janusz Korczak, the Jewish physician who had an orphanage of over 200 children. And he had a permission from the Nazis that is sort of a awarding of an exemption that he could never be rounded up. The Poles themselves admire then and admire now Janusz Korczak. But finally the word came that the 200 children in the orphanage were to be sent to Treblinka and gassed. And Janusz Korczak could have stayed in Warsaw, but he went with his children and died in Treblinka. And so he is a national hero, not just a Jewish hero, but a national hero. But his statue, I think, needs to be moved out in to central Warsaw. But I don't think they're going to pay attention to me. But here is another. We couldn't read Polish, and so I'm not sure. But these, again, are memorials to people during the Holocaust. To speed up the process in Warsaw, they sometimes brought across this large boulevard Jews from the ghetto, lined them up, and just mowed them down in the cemetery. So those white markers indicate where they had been lined up. And just a mass grave in this old traditional Jewish cemetery. This is Tykocin, a beautiful little village in northeast Poland, not terribly far from the Ukraine. And there's not a Jew left there, of course. This is an old shtetl. And that's the synagogue in that picture. Here's also a side view of the synagogue. Every home today is occupied by non-Jews, of course. They're all gone. The Polish government staffs the Holocaust and will explain the building and so on, much like our forest rangers do. This you can't see it, unfortunately. It's in the shadow. But there's a Star of David in the glass on this. So Jews used to live there, but it's not a Jewish family now. And here's a street. It's just beautiful and very, very quiet. It's a beautiful day. But what happened to the Jews of Tykocin, over 3,000 of them, I think it's closer to 5,000, is the Einsatzgruppen, which followed the Wehrmacht, the German army, into eastern Poland and on into the Soviet Union after World War II gets underway. This is where the Einsatzgruppen kill 1.3 million Jews by firing squads, by taking them out of their towns, cities, and villages to the nearest pit, ravine, or if not available, they'll have Jews dig the ravine or the pit and take them out, men, women, and children, everyone simply shot and pushed into, or fall into the pit and then cover it up. So we walked down the path which the 4,000 or 5,000 Jews on one morning were rounded up and walked 7 kilometers down into the, from Tykocin. Down here we're still finally getting to the location where they were shot. And here's fencing around the very spot. For 3 years after the killing, the ground was still like quicksand, just quivered from walking with all the bodies underneath it. To put it crudely, this is early in the war, the Nazis had a body problem and what to do with them. And the earth simply would not contain the dead. Hence the crematoria come to be developed. Here again, some of our group standing outside the fence. Kaddish is said here, a whole village destroyed in a morning. This was a sign along the road out on the highway pointing to this narrow road down to the site. It's in Hebrew so that Jews might know where the monument is. It's been vandalized, as you can see. So some anti-Semite destroyed that. This is Treblinka. I didn't know that Treblinka would affect me like it did because I knew it was totally destroyed. I mean, it was demolished, the original, but these monuments really tell the story. Treblinka was one of the three of the six death camps that were just for mass destruction. There was no additional slave labor or any other product other than death at a place like Treblinka. So here, these stones represent the ties of the railroad track. The train would pull up here, as the Nazis referred to it. The men's undressing room was over here. The women's undressing room was over there. The monument in the middle is the gas chamber, and then we'll see in a little bit where the crematorium was. So this was simply a factory, off the train, off with the clothes, into the gas chamber. Here is our group. You can see the black rock. That represents where the crematorium was. Okay, just a representation of it. I can't read Polish, so I don't. That was one slide that we bought. So these are now ones we purchased there, but this is how, I think it's very effective. You can see where the tracks were, then it curves in, and the train would pull up beside Treblinka. This is just some more shots that indicate the size of this place. There are just thousands of stones. Occasionally, one will have the name of a country from which the Jews came, but there's only one stone that has a person's name on it. But just look, this represents the multitude that died there. And there's the stone for Poland, Polish Jews. Again, here's the crematorium. By the way, the day in which this Treblinka opened, the Nazis set the workers there, the SS, set up in front of the crematorium and the gas chamber a full banquet dinner with white tablecloth, candles, and champagne, and drank and celebrated the initiation of Treblinka. Here again, you can see where the crematorium was, more stone. And there's Janusz Korczak, the man who came with his orphans, the only stone that has the name of a person. Here is the Wannsee Villa, just outside of Berlin. That was our, well, Holland, Berlin, Germany is our next to last stop, and then finally Holland. But this is the place on January 20th, 1942, where 15 top echelon Nazis met under the direction of Heydrich to plan the final solution. It only took an hour and a half, and they received the plan and then departed from that spot and began to execute the final solution. That meant the gas chambers and what you've just seen. This is now a museum just within the last year. It's hardly a year old now, converted into a museum by young Germans. They're very young. They're in their teens and their 20s. They did get the government to allow them to use the building, but it's literally a scotch tape exhibit. Excellent exhibit. Photographs and some artifacts and so on, but they've done it neatly, but it's scotch tape to the wall. It's almost no budget. No budget. These are a few dedicated young people who are trying to make some kind of contrition, I think. And it's well attended. Tour buses are pulling up. And finally, whether wanted really or not, Germany has a Holocaust museum. This is the very room in which the final solution was designed and the Führer's orders were transmitted. We're out of time, aren't we? Okay. So, any quickie questions?
we do have time for some questions. Like the lights on.
The only shot you're missing is one of the Anne Frank place.
Oh, wow.
No. Well, I mean, not inside, though, but that's the rope, and oh, this is Nazi Raus in Berlin, painted on the wall, out with the Nazis, but we saw others where the Raus was scratched out. That's Checkpoint Charlie. This is the Reichstag in Berlin. This is Amsterdam, and there is the line day after day after day outside the Anne Frank house. So that's an optimistic note to end on. That's like a pilgrimage, a holy place almost. And the crowds are that way all around through the year. So that's the slideshow. And I-